نعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ولن تجد له هاديا مرشدا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة فاللهم اجزه عنا أفضل الجزاء. Brothers and sisters, alhamdulillah, we are overshadowed by beautiful days, the last few days of Sha'ban. And inshallah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yuballighana Ramadan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us reach Ramadan and have the blessings of Ramadan, inshallah. Remember what we said about Sha'ban previously. Inshallah, in Ramadan, I'm going to give you an idea at the end about how our program is going to go in Ramadan. We, inshallah, between today and Friday, we will finish all the ayat that deal with al-usra, or the Muslim family. We said that in the part we're dealing with explains the rulings and ahkam of al-usra, or the Muslim family. But see, today it is not confined only to talaq, or relationship between husband and wife, but it also extends to the children in today's ayat, inshallah. We spoke previously about many rulings, and we spoke about abstinence as a punishment, that some of the men take an oath on themselves to abstain, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put a limit to that of 4 months, no more. We then spoke about al-talaq, or divorce, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put a iddah of 3 qurū', and we said the qar is a period, be that the period of impurity or the period of purity, depending on which madhab you are referring to. And we said, according to the question of my brother here, that if a woman is menopausal, then her iddah is 3 months, because she doesn't get any periods anymore. Another point I probably forgot to mention is that the iddah of a woman who is pregnant is the end of her pregnancy. The iddah of a woman who's pregnant is the end of her pregnancy. The significance of iddah is that the husband can return his wife during the period of iddah at any time with very few limitations. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned وَبُعُولَتُهُنَّ أَحَقُّ بِرَدِّهِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ. Their former husbands, or their husbands, have the highest right of returning them during that period. However, if the iddah elapses, then they have to start a whole marriage process from the beginning, including proposing to the family. And we mentioned that in the ayat that we are going to discuss today, inshallah. Then we went into the issue of talaq shouldn't exceed 2 times, and after the 3rd time, then they cannot get back together, and the woman cannot go back to her husband except if she gets married to another husband. And we talked about the muhallil, and how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam forbade using the muhallil for just breaching that rule. And there is nothing in Islam called tahleel, except if the man and woman marry with the intention of a lasting marriage. That's the second marriage. If the second husband divorces her, then she can go back if she thinks that she can have a good Islamic life with her ex-husband. They can go back together. Last time we finished by the ayat وَإِذَا طَلَّقْتُمُ النِّسَاءَ, we talked about al-i'dal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says وَإِذَا طَلَّقْتُمُ النِّسَاءَ فَبَلَغْنَا أَجَلَهُنَّ, when they fulfill their iddah, فَأَمْسِكُوهُنَّ بِمَعْرُوفٍ, either return them back بالمعروف. And we discussed the word ma'roof and munkar, right? We said ma'roof is what's accepted, what is known to be good. What is known to be good. Min arafa. Arafa, to know. Yes. Al-Khul, yes. Yeah, and there is a difference in ulama as to whether iddah, al-khul'a, if a woman does khul'a, Abu Hanifa says that this is talqa ba'ina wa niha'iyya. So there is no return from it, since she decided that. However, other scholars have a different opinions of khul'a. وَإِذَا طَلَّقْتُمْ النِّسَاءَ فَبَلَغْنَ أَجَلَهُنَّ فَأَمْسِكُوهُنَّ بِمَعْرُوفٍ أَوْ سَرِّحُوهُنَّ بِمَعْرُوفٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders us, once the woman reaches her iddah, you either hold her with goodness and good intentions, or let go of her also with goodness and good intentions and giving her all her rights. وَلَا تُمْسِكُوهُنَّ ضِرَارًا لِتَعْتَدُوا. We said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade completely that anybody holds his wife not with the intention of returning to a normal family relationship, but to just hurt her. Al-adha, to hurt her. Dirara, from darra. Darra means to hurt. To hurt. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade this completely, and he said, he reminds the people that do that as if they are jesting in the ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as if they are belittling the revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's how grave this situation is. And also reminds us of the blessings that we have by accepting the revelation of the Quran and the Sunnah. وَذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ وَمَا أَنزَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds people who do dirar that this is a blessing from Allah. You should never take it as a jest or make a joke of it or belittle it. And we also mentioned the person who threw the talaq on his wife 3 times in one session, and how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam got angry and stood up and left the gathering that told him that, and he said, أَيَتَّخِذُونَ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ هُزُوَى. Are they making fun of the book of Allah? وَأَنَا بَيْنَ ظَهْرِيكُمْ, and I am amongst you. How come a Muslim does that? Which is throwing talaq 3 times on his wife in the same session. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٍ. Fear Allah and be aware that Allah is all aware of all things. وَإِذَا طَلَّقْتُمُ النِّسَاءَ فَبَلَغْنَ أَجَلَهُنَّ. We concluded with this ayah last time, 232. وَإِذَا طَلَّقْتُمُ النِّسَاءَ فَبَلَغْنَ أَجَلَهُنَّ. If you divorce women and they reach their iddah, they fulfill their time limit. فَلَا تَعْضُلُوهُنَّ أَن يَنْكِحْنَ. Do not give them a hard time to go back to their former husbands. And we told the story at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when one of the people, his name was Mu'qal ibn Yasar al-Muzani, he gave his sister in marriage to a man of the Ansar, and when he divorced her and returned her to her brother's house after inqida' al-iddah, that's why we said after al-iddah elapses, the marriage process is a start over. He has to propose to the family, to the wali, and he has to offer dowry, which is different from returning her during the time of iddah. And when her brother forbade her from going back to him, this ayah was revealed. وَإِذَا طَلَّقْتُمُ النِّسَاءَ فَبَلَغْنَ أَجَلَهُنَّ فَلَا تَعْضُلُوهُنَّ أَن يَنْكِحْنَ أَزْوَاجَهُنَّ. Do not put obstacles on their way to go back to their former husbands. And when this ayah was revealed, the man went back on his word and said, you can come back. Uzawwijuka wa ukrimuk. I will let you remarry my sister, and I will even honor you. قَالَ مَعْقَلْ سَمْعٌ لِرَبِّ وَطَاعَةٌ. Full obedience and full submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ذلك يوعظ به من كان منكم يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put iman in Allah and the last day as a condition. If you breach that and put obstacles in the way of a woman who wants to go back to her former husband, then this is as if you are breaching your iman with Allah and the Yawm al-Akhir. ذلكم أزكى لكم وأطهر. This is more purifying for you. والله يعلم وأنتم تعلمون. For Allah سبحانه وتعالى knows and you do not know. This is where we stopped last time. The next ayah is a beautiful ayah about the rights of the kids. Look at this. So it starts with nursing, rules of nursing. وَالْوَالِدَاتُ الْوَالِدَة means the mother or the one who delivered. وَالْوَالِدَاتُ يُرْضِعْنَ they should nurse. أَوْلَادَهُنَّ their offsprings, their kids, their newborns. حَوْلَيْنِ 2 years. كَامِلَيْنِ full. لِمَنْ أَرَادَ to this who wants. أَنْ يُتِمَّ الرَّضَاعَ to fulfill and finish the time of nursing. So وَالْوَالِدَاتُ يُرْضِعْنَ أَوْلَادَهُنَّ حَوْلَيْنِ كَامِلَيْنِ لِمَنْ أَرَادَ أَنْ يُتِمَّ الرَّضَاعَ. And the mothers would be nursing their offsprings for 2 full months for those who want to fulfill the nursing period. Yeah, what did I say? 2 full years. حَوْلَيْنِ كَامِلَيْنِ 2 full years to this who wants to fulfill a rada'a. وَعَلَى الْمَوْلُودِ لَهُ this person who receives the newborn, who is referring to the father, الْمَوْلُودِ لَهُ the one who receives, who had an offspring to him. رِزْقُهُنَّ taking care of them, feeding them, وَكِسْوَتُهُنَّ and buying dress for them, بِالْمَعْرُوفِ again the word معروف, with what that is good. It shouldn't be cheap. لَا تُكَلَّفُ نَفْسٌ إِلَّا وُسْعَهَا لَا تُكَلَّفُ there is no obligation. نَفْسٌ on a soul, إِلَّا except وُسْعَهَا what it is capable of. So we will not exhaust the father by asking too much. No, I want this, that, and the other. So, وَعَلَى الْمَوْلُودِ لَهُ the father has an obligation, رِزْقُهُنَّ to give them rizq, meaning feeding them and giving them their needs. وَكِسْوَتُهُنَّ and dressing them بِالْمَعْرُوفِ even if they reach a point of divorce, it is an obligation of the father, on the father, to take care of the mother who is nursing his child. لَا تُكَلَّفُ نَفْسٌ إِلَّا وُسْعَهَا no soul should be overburdened with what exceeds its capability. لَا تُضَارَّ وَالِدَةٌ بِوَلَدِهَا do not use the child of a woman to try to hurt her. Do not use this as a weakness point to try to oppress the woman. لا تضار والدة بولدها. For example, kidnapping a kid from his mother. This is called تضار والدة بولدها. For example. So a woman should not be punished by being the mother of your child. Do not use the children to pressurize each other. And you can see that people do that all the time, unfortunately. لا تضار والدة بولدها a woman should never be hurt or harmed by having an offspring. ولا مولود له بولده do not try to hurt the man by being the father of your child. How? You take custody of the child, I don't want him. Suppose he can't. Suppose he has to work. Suppose he cannot support the child when he is too young. Suppose that he doesn't have the means to hire a wet nurse. So don't use, the same applies to the woman. The woman should never use the child to try to be punitive on the husband by giving him a hard time using the children. وَعَلَى الْوَارِثِ مِثْلُ ذَلِكَ in case of a heir, the death situation, then the person who inherits from the dead person has the same responsibilities as the dead person. He has the responsibility towards the nursing mother, the same as the man who left her behind, which is the family of the husband, has the responsibility towards the mother, the same way that he did. فَإِنْ أَرَادَ, if both mother and father want, فَإِنْ أَرَادَ فِصَالَ, to wean the child. We said that the nursing period is 2 years, right? فَإِنْ أَرَادَ فِصَالَ, if they want to wean the child, عَنْ تَرَادٍ مِّنْهُمَا, after they agree, both of them, وَتَشَاوَر, and after consultation, الشُّورَ. So it's not the decision of one side or the other. When it comes to weaning, it is a mutual decision between father and mother. Why? To guarantee the best interest of the child. Suppose the mother wants to wean too early because I want to go back to work. There has to be consultation and dialogue between mother and father. فَإِنْ أَرَادَ فِصَالًا, if they want فِصَال, يَفْصَل means to separate, meaning separating the child from the nursing process of his mother. And another word for فِصَال is فِطَام, وَفِطَامُهُ فِي عَامَيْن, أَنُشْكُرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيْكَ إِلَيَّ الْمَصِيرِ. So فِطَام is used as weaning also. فَإِنْ أَرَادَ فِصَالًا, if they want to wean the child, عَنْ تَرَادٍ مِّنْهُمَا, after they agree, وَتَشَاوُرْ, and consult each other, فَلَا جُنَاحَ عَلَيْهِمَا. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is allowing them to cut the nursing period short of 2 years, as long as they agree that this is to the best interest of the child. وَإِنْ أَرَدْتُمْ أَن تَسْتَرْضِعُوا, and if you want to hire a wet nurse for your child, فَلَا أَوْلَادَكُمْ تَسْتَرْضِعُوا, يَسْتَرْضِعُ, رَاضَعَ means to suckle, إِسْتَرْضَعَ means to hire a wet nurse. So رَاضَعَ means to suckle, إِسْتَرْضَعَ means to hire somebody from the outside to come and supply nursing for the child. وَإِنْ أَرَدْتُمْ أَن تَسْتَرْضِعُوا, if you want to hire a wet nurse, أَوْلَادَكُمْ, for your kids, فَلَا جُنَاحَ عَلَيْكُمْ, there is no blame on you, there is nothing wrong with that. إِذَا سَلَّمْتُمْ, if you hand over to them, مَا آتَيْتُمْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, you hire them, you pay them the way that you agree with them, at the same time you don't deprive the mother of her rights also. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ, and fear Allah. وَعْلَمُوا, and know, أَنَّ اللَّهَ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ بَصِيرٌ, is all aware, all seeing of what you are doing. وَالَّذِينَ يُتَوَفَّوْنَ مِنْكُمْ, and those who die from amongst you, وَيَذَرُونَ, and they leave behind. يَذَر means to leave behind. وَالَّذِينَ يُتَوَفَّوْنَ مِنْكُمْ وَيَذَرُونَ أَزْوَاجًا, and they leave behind a widow. So we left the issue of nursing and rights of the child. Now we're getting into the situation of a widow. وَالَّذِينَ يُتَوَفَّوْنَ مِنْكُمْ وَيَذَرُونَ, those who die from you. Tawaffa means to pass away. وَيَذَرُونَ أَزْوَاجًا, and they leave behind widows, ex-wives. يَتَرَبَّصْنَ, wait, hold on. بِأَنفُسِهِنَّ, hold on with themselves, hold themselves back. أَرْبَعَةَ أَشْهُرٍ وَعَشْرًا, 4 months and 10 days. So this is the period of حِدَاد, mourning, and the period of عِدَّة, for a woman, a widow. So for a widow, it is 4 months and 10 days, which is 130 days. 130 days. Why? To make sure that she is not pregnant. Again, back to the issue of pregnant or not pregnant. But this is most ascertaining of being pregnant or not. Remember the hadith of Ibn Mas'ud that he narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam teaches us that each one of us would be created as a nutfah. Nutfah means zygote, in his mother's womb for 40 days. And then another 40 days as alaqah. What's alaqah? Alaqah is a hanging drop. Hanging. Alaqah is hanging. So, see, yeah, so it hangs from the wall of the womb. So the zygote is the meeting of the two cells from the man and the woman, start to increase in number, and then it travels through the tube into the cavity of the womb, and then it hangs in the cavity of the womb. Okay, this is called the alaqa. From alaqa means to hang. Another 40 days as mudgha. What's mudgha? Bite. Yamdugh, to chew. Mudgha means bite. So it's the size of a bite. So these are the stages that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Surah Al-Mu'minun. وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ مِنْ سُلَالَةٍ مِنْ طِينٍ ثُمَّ جَعَلْنَاهُ نُطْفَةً فِي قَرَارٍ مَكِينٍ ثُمَّ خَلَقْنَا النُّطْفَةَ عَلَقَةً فخلقنا العلقة مضغة فخلقنا المضغة عظاما فكسونا العظام لحما. So these are the stages mentioned in the Quran. Subhanallah. 1400 years ago. So Ibn Mas'ud mentions that the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that each one of us would be created in his mother's womb as a nutfah for 40 days, then alaqa, hanging in the wall for 40 days, then mudgha, the size of a bite of flesh, for another 40 days, and then the ruh would be blown into the embryo. Okay? So 3 times 40 is 120. And then they added another 10 days, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to add another 10 days for the differences in months. 1 month it's 30 days, 1 month 31, 1 month is 28, just to be on the safe side. And the expectation of ulama is that after nafkh ruh, then the thrill or the minute movements of the embryo would kick in. And that is why it is extra safe to wait for 4 months and 10 days to make sure that the widow is not pregnant. So this is the period of iddah for a widow. So the iddah for a regular woman is thalathata quru, right? Thalathata quru. The iddah for a pregnant woman is, the pregnant woman is by the end of pregnancy. It could be 4 months, it could be 5 months, the end of pregnancy. The iddah for a menopausal woman is 3 months. Jazakallah khair. Okay, so the iddah of a widow is 4 months and 10 days, 130 days. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Hadith Sahih mentions that nobody who believes in Allah and the last day, no woman who believes in Allah and the last day should mourn anybody more than 3 days and nights, except her husband. It's 4 days and ten, four months and 10 days. Good point. Yeah. Okay. So al-idda or al-hidad, which is mourning. What's the meaning of hidad or mourning? What's the mourning? To put aside ornamentation, zina. She should wear the humblest of clothes and try not to leave the house as much as possible. Because in the days of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when a woman starts to put colorful clothes and ornament and start putting kuhl in their eyes, This is a sign that she is ready for marriage. So, during the days of the Prophet ﷺ, one of the women went to the Prophet ﷺ asking him, "My daughter is a widow, but she's complaining about something wrong with her eyes. Can we put kuhl in her eyes?" He said, "No, not before 4 months and 10 days. Because kuhl was used as a remedy. At the same time, it's a sign of ornamentation or zina, that the woman is ready to be remarried. Okay? وَالَّذِينَ يُتَوَفَّوْنَ مِنْكُمْ Those who die from you, وَيَذَرُونَ أَزْوَاجًا And leave behind a wife, a widow. يَتَرَبَّصْنَ بِأَنفُسِهَنَّ The woman should hold on for 4 months and 10 days. أَرْبَعَةَ أَشْهُرٍ وَعَشْرًا And 10 days. فَإِذَا بَلَغْنَ أَجَلَهُنَّ When they fulfill their iddah, their hidad, their 130 days, فَلَا جُنَاحَ عَلَيْكُمْ There is no blame on you, the family of the husband or the custodians. فِيمَا فَعَلْنَا فِي أَنفُسِهِنَّ What they do to themselves, ornamentation. After she exceeds her iddah, there is no blame on her or her custodian. What she does to herself so that she will be ready for remarriage or ready to be proposed to, بِالْمَعْرُوفِ Again, with what is good. So she doesn't take off her clothes and expose her hair. No. بالمعروف. والله بما تعملون خبير. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all aware of what you are doing. Now, a very good question here. Suppose a woman, a widow, dies, her husband dies, and she's pregnant. What's her iddah? End of pregnancy. So suppose the pregnancy is short, she's left with 1 month. What's her iddah? There are two sayings in this. There are two sayings. Since the ayat did not specify, some of the ulama, they say she should fulfill 130 days. She will pass by the period of what's remaining of her pregnancy, and she will pass by the period of what do we call it? The period of bleeding after delivery, postpartum, the postpartum bleeding. But some ulama say that she should fulfill the 130 days. However, there is a hadith on Rasulullah ﷺ that he allows a woman who delivered less than 4 months and 10 days, less than the usual iddah, he allowed her to get ornamentation so that she can be proposed to. So the two opinions are out there. Some of the ulama, they say that she should fulfill the exact iddah of a widow. Yani, the opinion is that she should take whichever is longer. If her pregnancy is 6 months left from the pregnancy, then once she delivers, she becomes available for marriage. The problem comes when what's remaining of her pregnancy is less than the time of iddah. Some of the ulama, they say, she should complete the iddah of 4 months and 10 days. Some say, no, once she delivered, according to the event that happened during the days of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There is the ayah. Four months and 10 days, without specification. Yes, yeah. So since the ayah does not specify, the ayah says, "وَالَّذِينَ تُوَفَّوْنَ مِنْكُمْ وَيَذَرُونَ أَزْوَاجًا," and they leave behind widows. Didn't specify what kind of widows. Didn't specify if the widow has the period or menopausal. Didn't specify. So the safest thing is 4 months and 10 days. وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرٌ We said that the ayah that mentions al-haml in Surah Al-Talaq, وَأُولَاتُ الْأَحْمَالِ أَجَلَهُنَّ أَن يَضَعْنَ حَمْلَهُنَّ And those who are pregnant, their iddah, their time limit is when they deliver their babies, or they deliver the hamla, the pregnancy. Sure.
Well, I do not know much about the knowledge, word of Quran, and the word of Allah. And but please don't judge me with my question. Because I'm playing catch up, you know.
Sure.
You've been talking about all these things, and you have spoken before. That 100% submission is required from us to Allah, right?
Yes.
And I don't think so that there is any word of Allah which does not carry benefit for me. So tell me, what is in it for me in total 100% submission?
I don't understand the question. Why do we have to submit 100% to Allah?
Why not? I'm saying that word of Allah, there is no word of Allah in which there is no benefit for me as a human being. It's all for us. It's for our benefit. It's all rules, regulations, everything. And once we go for 100% submission, you say, we have to do submission, 100%.
We try our best.
Yeah. But tell me, what benefit lies in it for me? For once I try to do submit, I submit myself 100% to Allah.
What is okay?
What's my benefit in that?
The benefit in submitting, trying to submit 100%. It comes from iman that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would never choose except for the best for you in any given situation. So the benefit of submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has multiple facets. It's a very good question, actually. Number one, can you imagine how much peace with yourself you will have when you have full submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? We fall into a crisis situation. Somebody is bothering you at work. Somebody is trying to make it difficult for you at work. If you have submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how much peace will you have with yourself when you say, I know that there is something good in this for me, and Allah, I accept. So no, this is number one. And this is a big issue. That's a big issue. Yani when Ibrahim alayhi salam, who was exemplary in his submission, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that Ibrahim has passed all the tests that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put him through, including slaughtering his son, whom he got after a long, long period of having no kids, from Jariyah, who was presented to his wife Sarah, and Sarah passed her on to him. Imagine that, all the struggling, okay? To the extent that when the Malaika later on, when after Ismail and after building al-Kaaba, and when the Malaika were on the way to destroy Lot, the people of Lot and Sodom, their city, when they give her the glad tidings of Ishaq, she slapped her face that, وَأَنَا عَجُوز, I am an old woman. How can I be pregnant? That's Sarah. So after all this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered him to slaughter his son. And knowing that he is a prophet, and knowing that the dream of a prophet cannot be dictated by the shaitan, he knows this is a message from Allah. What did he do? Submit. So there is no example of submission more than that. And it is said that from that point on to the end of humanity, no human being would be required to give that much submission or be asked to slaughter his own son after Ibrahim showed the submission. So the best thing I can think of when it comes to submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is peace. Peace with yourself. Peace surrounding you by the absolute belief down to the bone that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would never put something in my way except that has benefit to me. How many times have we been forced to change direction? Oh, I'm comfortable in Orlando, I have my own community, I formulated friends, I have my business, this, that, and the other, and then you are put in a situation where you have to move. Everything is collapsing on your head. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen something else for you. Imagine two comparable situations where somebody is fighting and fussing and swearing and using this word and that word, because why am I being put into this situation? Why am I, oh Allah, why are you putting me under this pressure? And somebody on the other end is saying, I believe deep in my heart that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there must be something good in it. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is forcing me to move in this direction.
Submissive.
So this is, yeah, I was talking about the first thing I can think of, which is psychological effect on us as human beings, as sinful human beings, as the brother is saying, that imagine the amount of peace you will be in when you are, the more submissive to Allah and His will we are, the more peace we have in our lives. And we struggle with this every day. Don't think that I am as submissive as I'm telling you to be. No. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mercy on me on any given day, I remember that. I remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is putting me in this situation and I am accepting. And then I find all good out of it. I tell you something. Last Friday, I love to do open heart. That's my specialty. So I was scheduled to do 4 open heart surgeries on one day. That's beautiful for me. I love it. I get exhausted, but I go home very satisfied. Professionally, very satisfied. So after the first heart, there are people in my vicinity at work who don't like to make me happy, doing what I love the most. So they try to get me out of this. And sometimes, bifadlillah yani, some people would feel belittled that I'm doing what I'm doing, that being a foreigner, being a graduate of Yale, so much intimidation to some people. You know what I'm talking about. So they told, there was another colleague of mine who had a patient die on the table in another end of the hospital, and they said, she can't work anymore, so we need you to go get her out. So at the beginning I said, oh my God, they are plotting. I mean, they could have chosen anybody else. So I ended up going to get this lady out, go home, because she is psychologically devastated. She had a patient die on the table with her. And I continued my day. Wallahi, it was the best of days. I ended up having time to pray Jum'ah, not only to pray Jum'ah on the other end of the hospital. I ended up giving khutbah al-Jum'ah, and I ended up leading salat al-Jum'ah. And most of the physicians who were praying behind me ended up working with me when I went back to work. So I was working with all Muslims for the rest of the day. Okay? So from my view at the very beginning, what was the first thing that came across my mind? Oh, they are plotting. وَأَمْكُرُونَ وَأَمْكُرُ اللَّهُ اللَّهُ خَيْرٌ مَكْرِينَ. But did it have benefit for me? Yes, probably if I were in open heart, I couldn't have done what I have done when I was excused and sent to the other end. How could I have given khutbat al-Jum'ah? Or how could I have led Jum'ah prayer I would have probably prayed Dhuhr, not Jum'ah, because if you have a 6-hour case and you're stuck with the patient, you can't leave. So that's just an example of how our short-sightedness, and that's the difference between training ourselves to accept the verdict of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as unquestionable, and working our own minds and thinking that we are in control. And here in our society, people love to feel that they are in control. وَظَنَّ أَهْلُهَا أَنَّهُمْ قَادِرُونَ عَلَيْهَا. One of the signs of the Day of Judgment, that people would think that they are capable and in full control of the earth. أَتَاهَا بَأْسُنَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would send the Day of Judgment on a day that people of the earth would think that they have absolute full control over the earth. You want some rain in there? I can give you some rain. You want sunshine? I can give you some sunshine. Ultraviolet rays? You want a tan? You don't have to go outside. We can give you a tan. Right? So, as Brother Mateen said, so the reward is both in this world and the hereafter. In this world, peace and prosperity. And the best for you. Where are you going to run away from Qadr? Are you capable of running away from Qadr? Where are you going to go? Right? And in the hereafter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, would reward us for as much submissive as we are, as much believing in Him that we are. Jazakumullah khair. You try your best. We try our best. Ibrahim alayhi salam was a very high rank in the sight of Allah. That's why he's called Khalilullah. Who is Khalil? It's the dearest of friends. Al-Khalil is my most intimate friend.
My question is, the rest of the humanity, are they not required to submit them like Ibrahim alayhi salam, 100%?
No. I didn't say that nobody would be tested as Ibrahim. I said that till the end of time, no human being would be tested by being required to slaughter his own son. Okay? No human being would be required to slaughter his own son. The grandfather of the Prophet ﷺ, he put an obligation on himself to slaughter his own son when he was given the honor of Zamzam control over the well of Zamzam. You remember that story? That he put Abdullah, the father of the Prophet ﷺ, to slaughter him. But he is the one who put this obligation on himself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't order him to do that. Exactly the story. Yeah. So that's why the Prophet ﷺ is named Ibn al-Dhabihain, the son of the two slaughtered, or to be slaughtered. Jazakumullah khair. Very good discussion. وَالَّذِينَ يَتَوَفَّوْنَ مِنْكُمْ وَيَذَرُونَ أَزْوَاجًا يَتَرَبَّصْنَ بِأَنفُسِهِنَّ أَرْبَعَةَ أَشْهُرٍ وَعَشْرًا. We said 4 months and 10 days. فَإِذَا بَلَغْنَ أَجَلَهُنَّ فَلَا جُنَاحَ عَلَيْكُمْ. If they reach their limit, there is no blame on you فِيمَا فَعَلْنَا فِي أَنفُسِهِنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. What they do to themselves, بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, with what is good. Be that to be married in halal, or to put herself out or announce that I have a daughter for marriage. She starts showing that she is ready for marriage. وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرٌ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all aware of what you do. وَلَا جُنَاحَ عَلَيْكُمْ. There is no blame on you. فِيمَا عَرَّضُتُمْ بِهِ. عَرَّضَ means to hint, to give a gesture. وَلَا جُنَاحَ عَلَيْكُمْ. There is no blame on you. فِيمَا عَرَّضُتُمْ بِهِ. In what you hinted or gestured. مِنْ خِطْبَةِ النِّسَاءِ. So when a woman is still in her period of عِدَّة, after a widow is still in her period of عِدَّة. How about if a man hinted to her that when she is done with her iddah, he's willing to marry her. Is that allowed or no? That's what the ayah is saying. There is no blame on you to hint, to give hints, that you will marry her, فِيمَا عَرَّضْتُمْ بِهِ مِنْ خِطْبَةِ النِّسَاءِ, that you will engage her into marriage after she is done with her iddah. Huh? Like hinting, indirect speech, like, oh, I was looking for a wife. I think I will be ready to get married in a couple of months. In her presence or the presence of her wali. Okay? I wish that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would grant me a good woman for marriage, because I'm ready for marriage. These are the hints that exemplify what the ayah, the verse is trying to say. وَلَا جُنَاحَ عَلَيْكُمْ, there is no blame on you, فِيمَا عَرَّضْتُمْ بِهِ, what you have hinted of, مِنْ خِطْبَةِ النِّسَاءِ, of engaging women. أَوْ أَكْنَنْتُمْ فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ, or if you have the intention in yourself but you didn't even hint, there is no blame on you for that. As long as it's going to be your intention is good, it's going to be in halal. عَلِمَ اللَّهُ أَنَّكُمْ سَتَذْكُرُونَهُنَّ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that you will mention it, mention them in your own hearts. When you see a woman who's a widow, you know that she's from a good family, she's a good Muslim, and you start thinking about it for marriage, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that you thought about her for marriage. Whether you hinted with that outside or whether you kept it inside, there is no blame on you. ولكن لا تواعدوهن سرا, do not take a covenant with them in secrecy, which means that rather than hinting, you would go, how about if I marry you? Or some people would marry the woman before her iddah is over, or promise her frankly to marry her, or ask her covenant not to marry anybody else. وَلَكِنْ لَا تُوَاعِدُوهُنَّ سِرَّ, this is what the word تُوَاعِدُوهُنَّ سِرَّ, to take a covenant with them in secrecy, to marry her without carrying out the whole marriage process except after she exceeds her iddah, this is haram. Or to ask her promise that she wouldn't marry anybody else except that person. This is not allowed. وَلَكِنْ لَا تُوَاعِدُهُنَّ سِرَّ إِلَّا أَن تَقُولُوا قَوْلًا مَعْرُوفًا, except if you are going to say what was mentioned above, which is only hinting. Why? You don't want to, if the woman is mourning or she is not ready, you don't want to put pressure on her. You don't want to put pressure on the family. You don't want to put obligation on yourself either. وَلَكِنْ لَا تُوَاعِدُهُنَّ سِرًّا إِلَّا أَن تَقُولُوا قَوْلًا مَعْرُوفًا وَلَا تَعْزِمُوا عُقْدَةَ النِّكَاحِ حَتَّى يَبْلُغَ الْكِتَابُ أَجَلًا, do not tie the knot of marriage until the iddah is fulfilled. So this pertains to people who do the marriage waiting for the iddah to be fulfilled, and then they can carry out the marriage under the same roof. So it's not allowed.
Somewhere in another ayah, I don't know if it's from Maryam or Teresa, the brother proposes a lady. Whoever proposes first, the second person
should subside. No, there is no mention of this in this ayah, but the ayah is talking about people who try to breach the iddah of a widow, frankly, rather than by just hinting that when the iddah is over, I could propose. That's all you're allowed to do. Either to think about her in your own self, in your own heart, or the most you can do is to just hint. But there are no formal proposals done. To somebody else.
Second person.
No, but you have, that's why you have hinted only. That's why the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He allowed the hinting. But the ayat or the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam talks about لا يبيع أحدكم على بيع أخيه. يعني I find that you are selling an item, and I go and I lower my price so people would buy from me. And we are Muslim brothers. I shouldn't do that. I know that you have already proposed and agreed to a dowry and stuff, and I go and I propose at a higher dowry, this better car, this, that, and the other. We shouldn't. The examples they give in the tafsir of Ibn Kathir, لا تقل لها إني عاشق. Don't tell her that I really love you, I am in love with you. This is tasriah. This is the thing that is forbidden from being said. لا تقل لها عاهديني ألا تتزواجي غير. Giving me a covenant that you will not marry anybody else. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means by, according to tafsir, لا تواعدوهن سرا. Do not take covenants on them in secrecy. No, actually, من خطبة النساء. The hinting is that I'm hinting that I will engage you after your iddah is over. ولا تعزم عقدة النكاح حتى يبلغ الكتاب أجله. And do not tighten the knot of marriage until the book reached its destination, which is the end of iddah. وَاعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْلَمُ مَا فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ فَاحْذَرُوهُ. Learn that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what your souls are hiding. So beware of Him, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَاعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ حَلِيمٌ. And learn that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all forgiving, all merciful. جزاكم الله خير. I'm going to stop here and because it's 9:43. جزاكم الله خيرا. Inshallah, just a touch about Ramadan. بإذن الله, I talked with Brother Mahfouz and Mas'ud, and we agreed with them that they will start Isha at 9:50, especially at least for the first week of Ramadan, because Adhan of Isha would be about 9:43 or 9:42, in that range for the first week or 10 days. So inshallah they will start praying Isha at 9:50. From 9:15 or 9:20 till 9:45, I will be giving a brief about the meanings, general meaning, general purpose of the whole juz that they will be reciting, with some quotations of the most important ayat, so that we interact better with the Quran. We understand what we're going to be standing in line.